good morning, church. As Kyle says, him and Brother Kyle and them, they're coming back from vacation, I reckon, still. Let's stand and sing for opening song, Lily of the Valley.
Be seated. I have just a few announcements to begin with. Those of you who tune in online with us, I know that you've been gracious and patient with us, and I want you to know we're working on some hardware issues and some different wiring components to improve your experience, so continue to hang with us and be patient with us. We will have that just lined out shortly, I'm sure. Sunday school, we're going to make some changes. No one knows about it really, so let me just tell you and we'll all be shocked together. We're going to move everyone back inside next week. So kids, no more sitting out in the sun. You'll be all right. Yeah. Now, we're based on our numbers, I think we may have to flip-flop some rooms, but we'll still be able to spread you out and abide by guidelines. So next Sunday, we're going to move everyone back in, but here's what else we're going to do. This won't be such a cheerful announcement, I don't think. We're going to move the start time a little bit earlier. So Sunday school will start at 9 o'clock. So you have to get out of bed earlier. There we go. So Sunday school, 9 to 9:45. Church service starts at 10, starting next week. So everyone getting into that, everyone cluing in. Help spread the word for those of your friends who aren't here. Sunday school, 9 to 9:45, worship at 10. Starting next week, everyone back inside. Still safety protocols, still all the same rules there. Also, I want to remind you of the ladies' book study going on Thursdays at 6:30. Be a part of that if you haven't been. It is a good thing. And next week is going to be an exciting Sunday because it will be our first Youth Sunday since we've been able to come back into the building. So we're going to have a Youth Sunday next Sunday. We're going to have Brother Nathan bring in our message. We're going to have some of our students involved in worship. It's going to be a good Sunday. It's going to be an exciting Sunday. So look forward to that next week. And let me just say thank you, Brother Butch, for jumping in last minute. I know many of you are expecting Butch Money to come and put on a concert. Butch Money's looking at surgery, and his doctor wanted him to quarantine, and so he's not allowed to get out now. And so, last minute, our Butch is jumping in. So thank you, Butch. I appreciate it. Let's get back to worship together.
All right, let's stand for America and happy birthday, USA. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of Mary. city's gleam, undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crowned thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. What we got next, guys? Battle hymn. I like to stay good and organized. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching. Seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory. He is coming like the glory of the morning on the wave. He is wisdom to the mighty. He is honor to the brave. So the world shall his footstool and the soul of wrong his slave. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. One more. Star Spangled Banner. I'm a little hoarse this morning, y'all bear with me. Well, I forgot the melody. Oh, say can.
Oh, is it? I got the wrong song.
I'm on the wrong song. You're supposed to fold it on the side you want to do. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where our fathers thank you for this day. Another chance to be in your house is just always a privilege, Lord. Honored to be here. Thank you for America. Thank you for allowing us and be with us and stay with us, Lord. We need you right now more than ever. Amen.
Well, if you have your Bibles today, we will be in 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel. Big surprise there, huh? 1 Samuel 23. 1 Samuel 23. Once again, thank you, Brother Butch, for jumping in like that. I appreciate it. And, of course, Miss Jan, we just jerk her around every week. She's used to it. She never knows what we're doing up here. 1 Samuel 23. The Lord knows what He's doing. As we do these studies through books like this, and we look to be expository in the preaching of the Word, and we come section by section, it never ceases to surprise me that where I'm at in my life, or what's going on in the life of the church, or where our country might be, God's Word is there. It's the living and active Word. It's a beautiful thing. And here we are, Independence Day weekend, celebrating our nation's independence, the birth of our nation. And, of course, I'm a history guy. I love history. I won't go into all the history because some of you aren't history people, but I'm sure you have at least a basic understanding of the formation of our country and the fight against what our forefathers considered to be tyranny and oppression. You know, the cries, no taxation without representation, and on and on. They saw an enemy they felt was oppressive, and they acted to earn freedom, to gain freedom, to establish a new nation. And here in our study, we're still looking at David fleeing from King Saul. And in the particular point we're at, we're going to see David is in dire straits, facing an enemy, and he needs to be delivered. There needs to be some type of battle won. There needs to be a victory on his behalf. He's not going to win it, but it's going to come nonetheless. And so let's look here in 1 Samuel 23, beginning with verse 19. Chapter 23, verse 19. Then the Ziphites came up to Saul at Gibeah and saying, "Is David not hiding with us in strongholds in the woods in the hill of Hachiliah, which is on the south of Jezimon? Now therefore, O king, come down according to all the desire of your soul to come down, and our part shall be to deliver him into the king's hand." And Saul said, "Blessed are you of the Lord, for you have compassion on me. Please go and find out for sure and see the place where his hideout is and who has seen him there, for I am told he is very crafty. See therefore, and take knowledge of all the lurking places where he hides, and come back to me with certainty, and I will go with you. And it shall be, if he is in the land, that I shall search for him throughout all the clans of Judah." So they arose and went to Ziph before Saul, but David and his men were in the wilderness of Maon, in the plain on the south of Jezimon. When Saul and his men went to seek him, they told David. Therefore he went down to the rock and stayed in the wilderness of Maon. And when Saul heard that, he pursued David in the wilderness of Maon. Then Saul went on one side of the mountain, and David and his men on the other side of the mountain. So David made haste to get away from Saul, for Saul and his men were encircling David and his men to take them. But a messenger came to Saul, saying, "Hurry and come, for the Philistines have invaded the land." Therefore Saul returned from pursuing David and went against the Philistines. So they called that place the Rock of Escape. Then David went up from there and dwelt in the strongholds of En-Gedi. Here's what's going on. You don't get it in the text unless you're familiar with the landscape and the terrain. But David and his band of warriors are in this mountainous region of Ziph. It's terrain that is rugged and it's difficult to traverse. It's very difficult to navigate. The people of Ziph are conspiring against David to turn David over to King Saul. And here we kind of come to one of the climactic points of Saul's pursuit of David. David and his ragamuffin band are in this rugged land. And when you study what most theologians believe to be this rock of escape and this mountain that's mentioned and the terrain, the picture is this. Saul is pursuing David. David and his band have taken up position, and because of the terrain, their escape is cut off. Saul most likely can see David's position and splits his army, and they flank David. So now David is being encircled by the enemy, and the terrain is preventing any escape. He's trapped. He's going to be caught. David is here with his band of warriors. Saul has finally got the high ground, flanked David, and there's no escape. You don't really pick that up in how it's spelled out here, but when you do the study of the terrain and how this was laid out, here's what you find. David couldn't escape. Saul's got him. Saul is going to capture him. Saul finally will capture this man he's pursued. He will finally put him to death. David is facing an enemy and he needs to escape. Only he can't escape in his own ability. Yet God intervenes. God moves. God acts on David's behalf and provides a way of escape. God moves upon the Philistines to cause them to attack. Saul has to pull his forces to go face the invading Philistines, leaving the way open for David and his men to escape, and they flee to a new place in Gedi to go take up hiding there. And so we see David escaping the enemy, and that's what I really want us to talk about today, escaping the enemy. The reality this morning is that there are many people struggling with many different forms of an enemy. There are many people struggling with things, looking for a way of escape, looking for a way to be delivered. Some people are facing enemies of hopelessness or anxiety or depression or fear. Some people are facing enemies they see in conflict with other people, hostilities with those around them. They are looking for a way of escape. They're looking for deliverance. We face enemies in this world. We face enemies. We live in a wicked world. It's a wicked world system. We face enemies. Now, we understand there's one true enemy of humanity, Satan himself, but all these other little enemies that pop up that we say, oh, if I could just escape this, if I could just escape my anxiety, if I could just escape depression, if I could just escape this conflict with this person or this. Listen, there's one enemy that's in the root behind all of it. And so today I want us to look at escaping the enemy. And in this text, I think we see three important things. So let's just delve right in. The first thing you need to see today is the enemy hunts us. The enemy hunts us. That's very clear. We see it in David. David had an enemy who hunted him, who pursued him. Saul hunted David persistently. Now, we didn't see that in this text, but if you were to back up to verse 14, you would find out that the Bible says Saul hunted David daily, daily, persistently, ongoing, continual pursuit. This wasn't just an attack and it was over. It was an ongoing, persistent pursuit. The enemy was after David daily. It was an ongoing pursuit. He was hunted by the enemy. He was hunted by an enemy who had superior strength and superior forces, superior resources. This was the king hunting David. He was the king of Israel. He had the resources of Israel. He had the strength of the army of the nation. David was outmatched, outgunned, and overwhelmed. The enemy who hunted him was superior. And David's enemy didn't just hunt him. David's enemy wanted to destroy him. Once again, not in this text, but if you were to back up to verse 15, you see the reason Saul was after him. It says Saul came out to seek his life. That is to destroy him. David was pursued by an enemy, hunted by an enemy who wanted to destroy him, obliterate him, rid the world of him. Well, David had his enemy, and you and I have our enemy. Humanity has an enemy hunting us. We face an adversary. You see, life is not easy. Most of you figured that out. Not even for Christians. I'd say maybe even especially for Christians, because we live in a world that's at odds with the kingdom we serve. It seems we're continually confronted with struggles, with attacks. But you know, Jesus very plainly stated, in this world you shall have tribulation. It shouldn't take us off guard, the reality that conflict is a part of our life. Spiritual attacks are a part of our existence. We have an enemy who wants to pursue us, who wants to hunt us, who wants to afflict us. The Bible says, you know this verse in 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, like a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. We have an adversary, one who opposes us, one who is on the prowl after us. The Bible calls him the devil, Satan, the adversary, the accuser, the one who rebelled against God and was cast out of heaven with a third of the angels. And these fallen angels, the Bible calls them demons. They conduct spiritual warfare against the saints of God. We have an adversary. We have those who oppose us. Spiritual warfare is a real thing. Conflict in spiritual life is real. This age we live in, that's how the Bible would describe it, the age, that is the world system. It exists and wars against the kingdom of God because it's under the rule of Satan. The Bible calls him the god of this age. Not that he's a god like the true God, but that he's been granted dominion. He's been granted dominion over the world system. It wars against us. We live in a sin-cursed world that brings continual conflict into our lives. What I'm trying to get you to grab a hold of is, listen, folks, life's not easy. And we do a disservice when we tell people, come to faith in Christ and all your problems are gone, because they're not. The difference is I now have the indwelling of God, the Spirit of God, His grace and His strength imparted to me to face the conflict and the hardship and the struggles, whereas before I didn't. We have an enemy. We have an enemy who has three main goals, according to John 10, to kill, to steal, and destroy. That's what the Bible says he's about. Satan wants to kill our faith, to steal our joy, to destroy our testimony as Christians. He's hunting. He's on the prowl. We have an enemy who pursues. For those people who have not come to faith in Christ, well, he still has those same goals for them. He wants to kill their bodies. He wants to steal their opportunity to respond to the gospel. He wants to destroy their soul in a place called hell. That's the enemy. That's the enemy. We can't take this enemy lightly. In Ephesians 6:11, it says he's crafty, he's wily, he uses schemes. He's got resources. He can appear as an angel of light. He's not to be taken lightly. We have an enemy. So here's where we're going with this. You have struggles in your life this morning. You have something you say, if I could just escape this thing. Well, I want you to look past that thing and see the real enemy. Your struggles, your conflicts, they're legitimate, but the real enemy is Satan. You're in conflict with that person at work. You're in conflict with that person in your family. That's not your real enemy. The real enemy is Satan, who's spurring the conflict. You're struggling with an emotional disorder of some sort. That's legitimate, and you should seek treatment, but look behind that to the enemy who wants to flare it up and use it against you. You have an enemy who's behind these things. We need to learn to recognize the enemy and not project our anger or our fear or our aggression at others or other things that's not even the real enemy. My brother or sister in Christ, who I have a tiff with, they're not the enemy. The enemy's Satan, who's spurring it up and egging it on. That person in my family who I'm cross with, they're not the enemy. Satan's the enemy who spurs it up and stirs it up and breeds conflict. We need to learn to identify we have an enemy. We have an enemy who hunts us, who seeks us, who wants to destroy us. He's lost your soul as a Christian, but he wants to destroy your witness and your effective kingdom work, your service to Christ. You have an enemy. Some of you are dealing with some major conflicts in your life, some major struggles. You're at a point of desperation. You want relief. What you want to do is escape. Well, initially, here's what you do. You recognize the enemy you face. But here's the second thing I want you to see. there is an escape. The escape provided us. We see it in the text. You see, David was hunted by an enemy, but there was an escape provided to David, just like there's an escape provided to us. God intervened so that David could escape the enemy. David, in his own plans and in his own might, didn't escape Saul that day. God intervened so that David could escape. And there are some conflicts in life, some struggles you have. There are some things that you're dealing with, and in your own might, in your own ability, you will not escape them. But when God intervenes for you, there comes the way of escape. Today, I want you to know God is intervening. He intervened for David. He made a way of escape. The Philistines attacked the land. Saul had to pull his troops and go handle this invasion. Now, you could think that was just luck, but it wasn't. You could think it was just happenstance, but it wasn't. In Proverbs 21:1, the Bible says, God takes the hearts of kings and steers them and turns them like a river. There's no doubt that God in his providence at just the right time had moved upon the hearts of those Philistine leaders to invade the land, knowing that Saul would have to pull his forces and David would escape. This is all the work of God. God in his providence moving to provide David a way of escape. God intervened for David, and David escaped the circumstances he couldn't handle. That's where some of us find ourselves today. You're dealing with things in your life, and in your own might, in your own ability, you haven't been able to break through. You haven't found a way of escape. Can I tell you today, you simply need God to intervene for you. That's your way of escape. And the good news is God has intervened on our behalf. He's already started this process for you. He has intervened for you to make a way of escape for you. He started it some time ago. Listen to the words of Colossians chapter 1, beginning of verse 12. Giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has, past tense, he has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood and the forgiveness of sins. The book of Colossians tells us God has intervened. He's already begun the work to intervene, to provide the way of escape. He intervenes on our behalf. And I think there are four particular ways he does that. So let me just point these out to you. You're in a point where you need God to intervene so that you can escape the affliction you're in. Well, God has intervened. Let me tell you four things he's providing for you right now. The first way that we can escape the enemy through God's intervention is this: through Jesus. Through Jesus, we are delivered from the power of the enemy. That's what Colossians 1:12 through 14 is about. Jesus has stepped in and delivered us from the power of the enemy, made a way of escape from what that passage calls the power of darkness. See, every person in this world, I don't care how nice a person you are, how great you are, how moral you are, how ethical you are, every person in this world is bound by the power of darkness until they come to faith in Christ. You're bound by it. You have no choice in the matter. You are born into this. The power of sin, the condemnation of sin, it reigns on all people. That's what Romans 3:23 and 6:23 is all about. We are born into sin. Sin rules and reigns. We live under this power of darkness, as Colossians calls it. It's the rule of Satan that dominates people. In John 8:44, Jesus very plainly says, if you haven't come to faith in him, you serve your father, the devil. You dwell under the dominion of darkness, whether you know it or not, whether you believe it or not, it's the reality. But the redemptive work of Christ has allowed us to be forgiven and transferred into the kingdom of God. How has God already begun to intervene on your behalf? Because he stepped in to give you a way of escape from the power of darkness, to transfer you into his kingdom, to transition you from spiritually dead to being spiritually alive, his child, abiding in his kingdom, a home in his heaven forever. It's the work of Christ. That's what Colossians says. It's redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Jesus stepped into our place, took our sin. Here's the reality. Some of you are struggling with something. You want a way of escape. You've tried this, you've tried that. You're doing everything you can to find relief, and you can't. And the bottom line is, the truth about it is, you've never come to faith in Christ. You're warring with your own power, fighting the dominion of darkness that you reside under, and you can't beat that. Only Christ can. What you need is to come to faith in Jesus. You need to come to the point where you say, Jesus, I understand and I believe you have died on the cross to pay for my sin. That you have risen from the dead. You've defeated death. You're alive right now. So Jesus, right now, I admit I'm a sinner. I need forgiveness. And I'm asking you to come into my life and forgive me. Jesus, would you rescue me from sin, from death, and from this affliction I'm under? That's where you need to start. See, God has already intervened to make a way of escape, and it begins with Jesus. And it's not of your own accord. You're not going to break through the power of darkness on your own. It's only through the power of Christ applied to your life through faith. You need Jesus this morning. That's what you need. Jesus. Jesus is your way of escape. But there's more. God has intervened in other ways. Secondly, through His Holy Spirit. See, through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, we're empowered to escape the enemy. When I come to faith in Christ, He doesn't just forgive me of sin. He doesn't just rescue me out of the dominion of Satan and transform me into God's kingdom. He indwells me. He empowers me. He equips me. The Holy Spirit, who is God, indwells us. He empowers us for faithful and fruitful lives in service to the kingdom, to honor God. How can I escape the enemy when I'm strong enough to run from the enemy or resist the enemy? And where's that strength come from? Not in myself, but through God, through the Holy Spirit. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the empowering of the Holy Spirit. You see, 1 Corinthians 6 tells us that the Holy Spirit not only draws us to faith in Christ, but then He indwells us, takes up residence, and begins to work to purify us of sin and lead us in spiritual growth to become like Christ, to take on the character of Christ, to be who we're called to be as God's children. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. He indwells us. And when we yield to the Holy Spirit's authority in our lives, what we find is we do not yield to those things that the enemy can use to ensnare us. When we yield to the Holy Spirit, we will not give in to those things that the enemy will use to entrap us. When we yield to the Holy Spirit, we will avoid those things that the enemy will use to combat us. When we yield to the Holy Spirit. In Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18 says, I say then, walk in the Spirit. You should not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Walk in the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Yield to the authority of the Holy Spirit. And He leads you in the paths you need to go. He indwells you and strengthens you. You see, much of the conflict we experience as Christians, many of the struggles we endure, they're all tied in with the flesh. That human side of us. And if we could learn to walk in the Spirit, we would automatically avoid so many of those things. If I could just learn to deny the flesh. Well, the Bible says to deny the flesh, I have to walk in the Spirit. I have to yield to the Holy Spirit moment by moment as I seek Him and live for Him and let Him lead me and teach me and guide me. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit allows you to escape the enemy. Because He just helps you avoid so many of the traps that the enemy would lay for you. Here's a third thing that God does in intervening. Through the direct intervention of God, the direct intervention of God, we escape the enemy. When God moves directly in our lives through His providence to provide us some way of escape or to protect us from the enemy. There are times where we come to faith in Christ. That's the first step. We have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And I'm living under the influence of the Holy Spirit. And He leads me here or there. And He strengthens me to resist. But there are times where God just has to directly intervene in my life. He's at work directly to accomplish His purpose. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13 says this, "No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it." There are about four really important things in that one verse. One thing is simply this, God is faithful, it says. God is faithful to see us through spiritual attacks. We have an enemy who wants to see us falter and fail, yet our God is faithful to see us through any attacks. He is faithful to be there. He is faithful. When you feel alone, you're not. When you feel hopeless, it's not. When you feel in despair, it's not. God is faithful. It says there that he won't allow the tempter to tempt you beyond what you are able. Oh, this is key now. God will not allow the tempter to tempt me beyond what I am able. Well, what's that mean? Well, you can't ever say the devil made me do it. Oh, I know I got into that, but I was just tempted beyond what I could stand. No, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says Satan can only tempt you as far as God will allow him, and he will not allow him to tempt you beyond what you are able. So you can't ever use the excuse, the devil made me do it. I just gave in to temptation. I couldn't help it. Nope, that's not what the Bible says. Because God is faithful to keep you from getting to that point. He won't even allow Satan to take you to that point. In fact, the Bible says when I sin, it's because I'm lured away in my own desires, my own lust. I've given in. It's of me. You got to remember that the Bible tells us in 1 John 4 that greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world. We have the indwelling of God. And Satan's not stronger than God. God limits him. Satan cannot subdue or overwhelm us with any enticement, with any temptation, with any attack. He's not stronger than God. That scripture says that the temptations that come, it says no temptation has overtaken you except as such as common to man. Common. There's no special temptation. Satan pulls out of his bag of tricks and no one's ever seen it or dealt with it and boom, it blew up on you and there's nothing that can be done. No. That's not how the spiritual attacks happen. Now, Satan's wily. He knows what to go after you and how to go after me, and it's not the same. But it's not anything that's uncommon. There's no supernatural event that Satan brings upon us that can't be endured or resisted. That's not how it works. Why? Because God is faithful. He intervenes. You got to remember that in the likeness of man, Jesus himself was tempted, endured spiritual attack, yet he remained perfect. Hebrews 2 and Hebrews 4 talk about that. The reality is this, Jesus understands temptation. He understands the allurement of sin. He understands the spiritual battles that go on. He understands being under spiritual attack. Jesus has been there. He understands. And that's the same Jesus who's in your corner. That's the same Jesus who says, I stand beside you. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He can help because he's been there. God intervenes. God intervenes directly. That scripture in 1 Corinthians 10 says he makes a way of escape. He makes a way of escape. When you're under spiritual attack, God often will make a way of escape. He'll give you a way out of the attack, especially a temptation or an allurement, an enticement to sin. Of course, you have to recognize the way of escape and take advantage of it. You know, maybe you're under some type of spiritual attack where it's just a spirit of negativity and you're negative and it's just like it haunts you. Everything's negative, negative, negative. And maybe God brings to your understanding, wait a minute, look at your running buddies. Birds of a feather flock together. Maybe you need some new running buddies. That's your way of escape if you're willing to take it. Or maybe you're struggling with temptation, enticement to some type of sin. And God says, look, here's an internet filter you could use, and that would help you. But you got to be willing to take it. There's your way of escape. Or here's an accountability partner you really need to be vested with. Get involved with them. God's going to make a way of escape so many times. But what if he doesn't? What if I'm under a spiritual attack? What if I'm enduring some type of problem or affliction and it just doesn't go away? I've been there and God just hasn't seemed to open up that door of escape. What then? Well, 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, God will work, last part of the verse, that you may be able to bear it. That you may be able to bear it, that is endure, is what that word means. Sometimes spiritual attacks come and there's not an immediate escape that pops up, but guess what God is doing? He's enabling you to endure the attack. He's pouring His grace and strength into you so that you can make it through. The attack doesn't immediately go away, but you're given the strength you need. And if that's happening, it's for a purpose. In fact, 1 Peter 5:10 says this, "May the God of all grace, who called us to His eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you." So the Bible says, sometimes you don't have an immediate way of escape. You're in the struggle. You're in a spiritual attack. It's going on. God doesn't just open the door and say, run. He says, you're in it. Let me strengthen you. Let me pour grace into you. You're going to endure this. Why? So that I can perfect you and establish you and strengthen you and have you settled in your faith. It's to make you stronger. It's to grow you. It's to better equip you for the next time you face the enemy. So some of you are in struggles and you're like, God, you just haven't made a way out yet. What's going on? Well, maybe He's saying, I'm going to strengthen you to endure. So that when you come out on the other side, you're stronger. You're more established. Your faith has grown. You're perfected in this process. But 1 Peter 5 says this, after you have suffered a while. Can I tell you, if you're in that midst, if you're in that midst in that moment, and it seems like this attack has been going on, you're under some type of conflict or some type of oppression, and God just hasn't delivered you, and you know that He's going to be working in you, and you know that He's strengthening you, let me remind you, the Bible says, for a while. For a while. That means there's an ending point. It's not forever. It's not going to be ongoing with no end. There will be an end when God says, okay, you've made it. You've learned what you need to learn. You've grown how you need to grow. You're strengthened in the way you need to be strengthened. It's time for it to end. Here's a fourth thing that God does to intervene to provide a way of escape. And that's through the love and support of our church family. We can escape the enemy. With the love and support of our church family, God established the New Testament church. You realize that, right? The Jewish people had synagogues. They had places of worship and learning. But after the resurrection of Christ, after He commissions the apostles, after the Holy Spirit comes upon them and they begin to preach on the day of Pentecost, you have this formation of something known as the church, where God's children come together to support one another, to care for one another, to enrich and enhance one another, to strengthen one another, to carry one another's burdens. In 1 Corinthians 5, Paul admonishes the church there to intervene in the life of a man who's under spiritual attack and succumbing to a lifestyle of sin. In Matthew 18, Jesus speaks about Christians intervening in the lives of each other. In Galatians chapter 6, the Bible says that we should bear one another's burdens and seek to restore a Christian who's succumb to a spiritual attack. We're to be actively working for one another to help one another in the midst of being attacked, succumbing to spiritual attack. In our struggles, we're to support one another. See, the church should be this safe haven where those who are struggling can find support and deliverance. People should be able to come into the church and say, I'm faithfully seeking Christ, but I have such a terrible struggle. I'm under such attack in this part of my life, and I need help. And the church rises around and says, we're here to support you. We're here to pray for you and love on you. We're here to walk beside you in whatever you're struggling with. That's how the church should work. The church should be this place where there's a safe haven, a safe port of call for me to dock my ship and say, here's where I flattered, here's where I failed, here's where I struggle, and here's where the enemy's after me. I need help. And people rally around me, put a loving arm around me, and say, let's pray, and let's see what we can do. The church needs to be a bastion of your support. And so we see there's an enemy who hunts, but there's a way of escape that's provided. But there's one really important section here, really important thing we see in David that we cannot ignore, and that is the effort from us. The effort from us. We see that in David's actions. You see, David immediately left the area that posed a threat. He was in this mountainous region. He had gotten himself cornered. He was flanked by the enemy. He was going to be captured. God made a way of escape. God delivered him from the enemy. And he didn't stay in that spot. He didn't stay where it was dangerous. He immediately left. He deliberately traveled to En-Gedi. He took action himself to move on. He took measures to protect himself from being entrapped by the enemy again. He didn't stay where he could be trapped again. He took measures on his own. He took effort. He was intentional to move on where he would be in a safe spot. Can I tell you, my friends, we must put effort in avoiding the snares of the enemy. We have an enemy, we recognize that. God intervenes on our behalf, yes, but you and I need to be deliberate. We need to put some effort into taking certain actions that will safeguard us from being ensnared, from being afflicted, from being attacked. Now, you're not going to do away with every spiritual attack. That's just not the case. As long as we're in this world, we'll deal with spiritual attacks. But we can do certain things that will limit his ability to attack. See, we can be deliberate in taking advantage of God's movements to deliver us and be intentional to take measures that will protect us from being ensnared and entrapped and afflicted. Let me share with you a few of these things. What can I do intentionally that will help me guard against an attack of the enemy? The first thing is this: move on past our old ways. We need to move on past our old ways. That's what the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4. If indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Here's the truth. Some Christians are continually being afflicted by Satan in certain areas of their life simply because they're still carrying some of the old garbage of their old life. They've brought along the old stuff they used to be in, and they've just kept it. And it gives Satan perfect opportunity to continue to afflict them. They've held on to aspects of that life that they lived before they came to faith in Christ. Those habits they had before they came to faith in Christ. Some of us are carrying baggage of that dominion of darkness that we came out of. And as long as we drag that baggage around, the enemy has a foothold to keep attacking. Some of us need to drop the garbage and just say, you know what, I'm done with that. That's what I used to be. That's not who I am anymore. I'm leaving it behind. We need to put the old things away. Pick up the new life we're called to. Be deliberate in putting on the character of Christ, living in the character of Christ, being intentional about pursuing the righteousness and the holiness of God that we're called to. That's what the Ephesians 4 passage says. We're created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Put the garbage away and pursue righteousness and holiness. Satan doesn't deal in righteousness and holiness. He deals in garbage. Drop your garbage. That's what some of us need to do. Here's a second thing we can do. We can flee things that lead to spiritual attack. We need to flee certain things. If I know there are areas of my life that I am prone to get into trouble with, I need to flee those areas. I need to flee those things. In 1 Corinthians 6:18, 2 Timothy 2:22, the Bible says, flee those things that tempt you sensually. Those things that tempt you sensually, that appeal to the flesh, flee, run away. Why? Because when you dabble in them, the enemy has a place to ensnare you. 1 Timothy 6, 9 through 11 says, flee from worldliness. Dabbling in the world, trying to conform to the world, pursuing worldly standards, being engulfed in what the world has. You need to flee. Why? Because that is a ground where the Satan, the enemy, can attack. 1 Corinthians 10:14 says, flee all things that may become an idol in your life. any of those pursuits you have that draw upon you so much that they can supplant God on the throne of your heart, they can become your number one priority, they can consume you. The Bible says flee from those things because it's a ground where Satan can ensnare you. Flee areas you know open you up to spiritual attack. Flee those places. Flee those things. Stay away from it. You know, when I was a young man and had few cares in the world other than running around and having a good time, I had an older model truck and had my fancy wheels, and it was a pretty cool ride. Man, I'd hand wash it, and I'd wax it. Let the wax cure, I'd wax it again. I'd armor all it, I'd shine it up. Because, you know, every Friday, Saturday night, you got to hit Front Street and Conway and cruise, all that kind of stuff. Man, I'd shine that truck up. But here's the thing. Once I got that truck shiny, there were some of my friends' houses I wouldn't go to because I wasn't driving down a dirt road. There are certain places I wouldn't drive my truck because I got it shiny. The reality for us is this. We need to avoid certain areas that's going to dirty up the shininess of our Christian life. There's certain aspects of life, certain people, places, and things you should flee from because you know there's going to be some dirt get up on you. Don't go where you know the enemy will attack you. Here's a third thing we can do. We can feed the Spirit and not the flesh. Feed the Spirit and not the flesh. In Romans chapter 7, you have this detailed explanation Paul gives, and we won't go into all of it right now, but the short version is this. There's a battle between the renewed mind and the old sinful flesh. There's this war that rages between the born-again spirit within us and the human desires of the flesh we're still tied to. There's a war, a battle that goes on. The spiritually born-again person who wants to please God, who wants to seek God, who wants to serve God, and that human flesh that's in us that wants to be pleased with sinful desires, and there's a battle that rages. The victory in this war basically comes down to, well, who's going to be the strongest? That spirit or that flesh? Which am I strengthening the most? Who am I feeding into the most? This past week I was reading and I came across a story of this old Cherokee man who still followed the old ways of his people. And he tried his best to teach his family the old ways. And he had his grandson with him. And he set his grandson down and said, "Grandson, there are two wolves inside of every man. The two wolves are continually fighting one another. One wolf is evil." He said it's anger, envy, jealousy, sorrow, regret, greed, arrogance, self-pity, guilt, resentment, inferiority, lies, false pride, superiority, and ego. The other wolf is good. It is joy, peace, love, hope, sincerity, humility, kindness, benevolence, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith. And grandson, these two wolves are fighting within you. As I read the story, the grandson eventually asked the question, "Well, Grandpa, which wolf will win?" The old brave rocked back and said, "The one you feed. The one you feed." And I'm not going to take Native American mysticism and equate it with Scripture, but that's a good illustration. If you want your spiritual nature to win the battle over that sinful flesh, then feed that nature. Feast on the Word of God. Work out in prayer daily. Feed the Spirit so that in the battle with the flesh, it's stronger and it will win. You see, our flesh gets fed every day. If you wake up tomorrow morning, your flesh is going to be fed just being in this world. You can't look at the TV. You can't look on your phone. You can't see social media. You can't look anywhere without the flesh being fed. You have to work so much harder to feed the Spirit. You have to be intentional. You have to work at it. You have to get into it. You have to get into the Word, into prayer. You must work hard at submitting to God. If I want to feed my spirit, I need to learn to submit to God in all things. James 4:7 says, "Submit to God. Resist the devil, he'll flee from you." Submit, though. Submit to God. Put effort into yielding yourself to God in every area of your life. That enables you to resist the enemy. Part of this goes back to where we started with 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant. That's self-controlled and alert. We need to be self-controlled to do this. We have to be disciplined to abide under God's authority and to feed ourselves spiritually. We need to be alert to understand the attacks of the enemy, the allurement of the enemy, the threats to God's position in our lives and His plan for our lives. We need to feed ourselves spiritually. One last thing you and I can do, and we'll wrap this up today. We need to conduct spiritual health evaluations. And that sounds kind of hokey. I know it does. I read that out loud this week and thought, what? What did I just write? That's hokey. Spiritual health evaluation. But it's scriptural. Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, know my anxieties, and see if there's any wicked way in me. Lead me in the way everlasting. You know what that prayer is? That's a spiritual health evaluation. It's saying, God, would you examine me spiritually to see how healthy I am? Search me, try me, test me, seek everything in me to see how sincere I am in my faith, and the sin that's there, expose it to me. I want to be healthy spiritually. I just wonder. If you go to the dentist to have your teeth cleaned, and you go for your checkups at your doctor, and you do whatever you're supposed to do health-wise to make sure your body's healthy, how much emphasis do we ever put on saying, God, could you do a spiritual examination? Could you take some spiritual x-rays? Could you do a spiritual blood draw? God, could you check my spiritual health that I might be spiritually healthy? Because you know, if you're physically weak and an enemy attacks you, you have a hard time fighting them off. But today I'm telling you have a spiritual enemy. You're trying to fight being spiritually weak. It's time to get some, I don't know, just a serious nature, I guess, about examining ourselves and making sure we're spiritually healthy because we face a spiritual enemy. My friend, it could be that today you have that struggle going on in your life. You have something you want deliverance from. You need an escape. Well, let me start here. Do you know Jesus? Have you met Him personally? Because that's where we begin. And then you move on to say, God, would you help me be sensitive to your Holy Spirit and follow His leadership as I pursue you and a way of escape from this thing? But God, in the midst of this, will you give me the strength and the grace I need to be grown, to be strengthened, to be perfected in faith through this struggle? It could be that you've come in through a struggle simply so that God can strengthen you to the point to help a brother or sister in a similar struggle. I don't know what's going on in your heart. I don't know what struggles you have, but here's what I do know. God has intervened. Call out to Him. I'll be happy to pray with you. You can pray right where you're at. I'm going to have a word of prayer now, and then we're going to have a time of invitation. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you, Lord, that you are always with us, that you have promised to never leave us nor forsake us. And even when situations seem dire, even when circumstances are overwhelming, even when we need relief and it doesn't seem to come, Lord, you're there. Your grace and your strength are being perfected in us. Lord, I'd pray for my brothers and sisters. Some of them may have struggles right now. They're seeking relief and a way of escape. God, I pray that you would move in their lives, that you would stir in their hearts, and that you would let yourself be known. Lord, I pray that you'd bring the escape they need. But Lord, if in your divine wisdom you have purpose in the struggle they're in, would you give them confidence and peace in who you are and in your plan for their life? Would you impart grace and wisdom to them? Would you impart strength and peace to them to endure the struggle that's upon them? Lord, for those who are hearing me who've never come to faith in Christ, they're struggling, they're wanting relief, but it just won't come. God, I pray you would open up their understanding that the relief will be in Jesus. would you help them move accordingly? Lord, thank you for all that you do for us now. In the name of Jesus, amen.